Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the fifth tutorial in the AVR series using the explained mini development board from Microchip, and today we will start working with I2C, the inter-integrated circuit. The I2C is a very popular communication standard developed by Philips, and it is used by many devices to transfer the data using only two wires. We will understand the communication protocol in a while. Let's see the datasheet of the AT-Tiny817 controller first. It supports the two-wire communication interface, and fully compatible with the Philips I2C interface. It supports the standard mode, the fast mode, and the fast mode plus. It can operate as a host or client independently. It has the hardware support for the client address match, and can recognize a 7-bit host address. The two lines are needed for communication using the I2C. SCL is the clock line, and SDA is the data line. Here you can see the communication protocol. A start condition is generated on the bus, when the data line is pulled low, while the clock is still high. Similarly, a stop condition is generated, when the data line is pulled high while the clock is high. Our entire frame is transferred between these start and stop conditions. After generating the start, we send the 7-bit slave address followed by the read or write bit. This bit must be 0 if the master wants to perform the write, and it should be 1 if the master wants to perform the read operation. If the address matches with the address of any of the devices on the bus, the respective device sends an acknowledgement signal. On receiving the acknowledgement, the master starts transmitting data. After receiving each data byte, the slave sends an acknowledgement signal. After all the data bytes have been transmitted, the master sends a stop condition. In the first few tutorials, we will be using the MCU in the master mode, or the host mode. Here you can see the steps for the host initialization. Basically, we need to set the baud rate for the clock frequency, and then enable the TWI host in the control register. We will see it in the registers. Here we have the formula to calculate the value for the baud register. There are different formulas available, but we will use this one. Let's check the pinout to see the available pins. Here you can see the pin PA1 is the data pin, and PA2 is the clock pin for the I2C. We will use these pins to connect to the slave device. Now before we proceed any further with the datasheet, let's start the IDE and create a new project. I have switched to MPLABX IDE as it is supported in macOS, but I will keep uploading the Microchip Studio project on the website. The process might be different for each IDE, but the code remains the same. I have connected the development board to the computer. Let's create a new project now. The device is AT-Tiny817, and the board has a built-in debugger tool. Let's choose the AVR compiler, and click Next. Give the name to the project, and click Finish. We need to manually add the main file to the project, so right-click on the source files, and add the main file. Here is the project from the previous video. We will copy the clock initialization section from it. Let's paste it in our main file, and call the clock initialization in the min function. We will create separate library files for the I2C, so that we can use it for other projects as well. Let's start with a new source file, and call it i2cmaster.c. Here we will first include the AVR IO header file, so that it has access to all the registers. Now write a function to initialize the I2C. Let's check the registers in the datasheet. We will leave the control A register to its default state, so the STA setup time is 4 clock cycles, there is no STA hold time, and the interface is operating in standard mode or the fast mode. The debug control register is also unmodified, so the interface will also halt when we halt the debugger. The host control A register is generally used to enable different interrupts for read, write, etc. We are not working with interrupts for now, so let's leave them disabled. The inactive bus timeout is also disabled. The smart mode can be used to send the auto acknowledgement to the slave after reading the data register. We will keep it disabled also, and manually send the ACK or NACK responses. The bit 0 of this register enables the interface, so we will only write a 1 to this bit. So let's write the value 1 to the host control register A. Next is the host control register B. The flush bit clears the internal state of the bus and changes its state to idle, we will leave it disabled. The acknowledge action bit decides whether the master will send an ACK response, or a NACK response. When the smart mode is enabled, whether to send an ACK response or a NACK response, is decided by this acknowledge action bit. Since we are not using smart mode, we need to send the response manually using the command bits. While I was testing the project, the bus wasn't running when the I2C was initialized with this bit kept to zero. So let's enable this bit for now, and we will modify it before reading some data from the slave. Next are the command bits. These bits decide the response of the host. The host can issue a repeated start condition, or an acknowledge action after reading the data from the slave, or the stop condition. We will control it in between the writing and reading operation, so let's keep it at zero for now. So we only need to set bit 2 in the host control register B. Instead of writing the numbers, I am going to write the name of the bits, so it will be easier for you to understand it. We need to write a 1 to the bit 2 of the control register B, which is equivalent to setting a NACK response to the acknowledge action bit. Next is the status register, which will play an important role throughout our project. The read interrupt flag is set whenever the host finishes reading a byte from the data register. The write interrupt flag is set whenever the host finishes transmitting an address, or a data byte. The received acknowledge bit holds the most recent acknowledgement status from the slave, so it helps us decide whether the slave sent an ACK or NACK response. Other bits are dedicated to different errors, which arise during the transaction. The first two bits hold the current state of the bus. Next is the board register. The value in this register will decide the frequency of the I2C clock. As I mentioned in the beginning, we will use this formula to calculate the value of the board register. The peripheral clock is at 5 MHz, and we will keep the I2C clock frequency at 100 kHz. The value of TR can be found in the electrical characteristics of the controller. Here you can see for the clock frequency up to 100 kHz, the value of TR is 1000 nanoseconds. Let's set all the values in the formula now. The value for the board register comes around 17.5. I will set it to 18, as we can't set the decimal value in an 8-bit register. The next register is for the address, and then we have the data register. That is all the registers we have for the I2C host. Now one last thing we need to do is set the pins in the I2C mode. This can be achieved in the port multiplexer register. Here the control B register can be used to set the respective pins in the twin wire interface. To do so, we will write a 1 to the fourth bit of this register. Alright, that completes our I2C initialization. Now let's write another function to send the data via the I2C. The parameters of this function will be the 7-bit slave address, the pointer to the data to be sent, and the size of the data. Let's take a look at how the communication protocol actually looks. The master sends a start condition, followed by the slave address. The slave address consists of the 7-bit address, plus the read or write bit, which decides whether the master wants to perform a read or write operation. Writing a 1 to this position means the master wants to read the data, and writing a 0 means the master wants to write the data. After receiving the address, the slave sends an acknowledgement signal, and then the master starts transmitting data bytes. After each data byte, the slave sends an acknowledgement signal, and once all the data has been transferred, the master sends the stop condition. The ATtiny do not have the means to control the start bit separately. When we send the address, the start bit is generated automatically. So we will first define a new 8-bit address, which is made by shifting the 7-bit address to the left, and then adding a 0 to the least significant position. This indicates that the master wants to write the data. Now load the write address to the address register, and wait for the write interrupt flag to set. The setting of this flag indicates that the address transmission has been finished. Now the slave will send an acknowledgement after receiving the correct address. The 4th bit of the status register will be 0 if the slave has sent an ACK response, and it will be set to 1 if there was an ACK response from the slave. So we will only proceed if there was an acknowledgement from the slave. Here we will check if the RX acknowledge bit in the status register is reset or not. If it is, the master will start transmitting the data. Let's define an index variable, which will keep track of how many bytes have been sent. Now we will only write the data if the slave acknowledges the received data, and if the value of the index variable is less than the data size. To transmit the data, we will copy the data to the data register, and increment the index variable. Then wait for the write interrupt flag to set, which indicates that the data has been transmitted. This loop will run till all the data bytes have been transmitted. If the slave does not acknowledge the address, we need to stop the transaction. To do so, the master will send a stop condition by modifying the command bits in the control register B. Let's change the function type, so that we can return different errors, in case there is some issue while transmitting. When all the data bytes have been transferred, the value of the index variable will be equal to the size parameter. And when this happens, the master will again send the stop condition and return success. This is enough for writing the data. Let's build the code once to check for any errors. Alright, let's include the I2C master header file. This file is not present in the project, so we will create it now. Here we will just define those two functions, so that we can call them in any other file also. We will not be using any slave device today. We will simply check if the master is able to transmit the data or not. So let's comment out the parts where the master waits for the acknowledgement from the slave device. Now the master will send the data irrespective of whether the slave is ready to accept it or not. Basically, the master will send the address and wait for the address to be transmitted. Then it will send the data, and wait for each data byte to transmit. Once all the bytes have been transferred, it will send the stop condition. The pins PA1 and PA2 are the data and clock pins. I have simply connected a logic analyzer to these pins, and we will see the I2C frame in the logic software. In the main function, include the I2C master header file so that we can call the I2C functions. Now in the main function, call the I2C initialization and give some delay so that the bus initializes completely. Let's define an array that we need to transmit via the I2C. Now in the while loop we will call the I2C write function. Let's give a random device address 15 hex, the data is defined above, and the size is 11 bytes. This function will be called every 1 second. Alright, the code builds fine, so let's test it. Let me start the logic software, so that we could see the I2C frame on it. The data line is connected to channel 1, and the clock is connected to channel 0. Let's flash the code to the board. Here you can see the transmission is happening every 1 second. Let's check the frame. At first we have the start bit, the green dot. It is followed by the slave address 15 hex, with the write request. There is a NAC response as there is no slave connected on the bus to acknowledge it. Even after receiving the NAC response, the master continues to transmit the data. You can see each byte of the data is followed by the NAC response. After the master sends the entire data, hello world, it sends a stop condition, the orange dot. So the I2C code works and we were able to transmit the data as the I2C master. In the next tutorial we will connect an actual slave device and send the data to it. Then we will write the function to receive data as the master, and try to read data from some sensor or memory device. This is it for the video. I hope you understood how to initialize the I2C, and write the function to send data to the slave. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.